Hello everyone, welcome again to Applied Linguistics 1. In this video, we are going to continue our discussion of second language acquisition. Today, we are going to talk about the first second language acquisition theory, which is that of behaviorism. Behaviorism is a theory that tries to explain how humans and animals learn and develop their behaviors. It claims that behaviors are formed through interaction with the environment. Behaviorists believe that behaviors develop through a process of habit formation using stimulus, response, reinforcement, and repetition. Behaviorism considers that language is a human behavior that develops through the same processes of habit formation. They do not take into consideration the role of mental, biological, and emotional factors in language learning. In the behaviorist jargon, learning a new behavior is called conditioning. We can identify three kinds of learning, which means three kinds of conditioning: classical conditioning, operant conditioning, and social conditioning. In what follows, we are going to explain each one of them with examples for second language acquisition. Classical conditioning is developed by Pavlov in his famous experiment with a dog. Pavlov observed that the dog salivates when it sees food, but it does not salivate when it hears the sound of a bell. Pavlov wanted to change the dog's behavior and make it salivate in response to the bell. So, Pavlov always rings the bell before he presents food to the dog. After he repeated this many times, he observed that the dog salivates when it hears the sound of the bell, because the dog knew that the food comes after the bell. The dog created an association between the sound of the bell and the food and starts to salivate in anticipation for the food. Thus, Pavlov succeeded in changing and modifying the dog's behavior. Now, let's see how this is applied in second language acquisition. The same techniques are used by second language acquisition teachers. They provide learners with pictures of objects followed by the sounds represented by the objects of the picture, like the picture of an apple followed by the word apple. Then they ask students to repeat until they internalize the association between the picture and the word. So, the next time students can understand or use the word without the picture. The same principles apply to language rules and structures. The second type of learning is called operant conditioning. This one was developed by B.F. Skinner. Operant conditioning is different from classical conditioning in that it is based on the idea that learners will repeat the same behavior in anticipation for a reward, or they will avoid some behavior in fear of punishment. Accordingly, second language learners will use correct forms of language in order to get some positive feedback from the teacher. Also, they will work hard to get good marks. Learners also avoid making mistakes so as not to be punished by getting negative feedback, bad marks, or fail in the exam. The third type of learning is called social conditioning or social learning. This one is very simple and it is based on the idea that learners will imitate people they admire. In this regard, second language teachers should set a good example for their students. Students will imitate the teachers that they like and they will learn easily. If they don't like the teachers, they will find it difficult to learn. However, learning a second language is not an easy task according to the behaviorists, as it faces many challenges. The biggest of these challenges is the first language. Second language learners already know a first language and they tend to transfer the rules and structures of their first language into second language. This results in errors in second language. So, behaviorists claimed that learners should switch off their first language when they are learning the second language. That's why they created the contrastive analysis hypothesis. Contrastive analysis hypothesis postulates that we need to compare the first language and the second language of the learner in order to identify similarities and differences between these two languages. Similarities between the first language and second language will facilitate learning the second language, whereas differences between these languages will most probably cause errors in second language. Contrastive analysis hypothesis is based on the idea that we need to predict these errors and try to prevent them before they happen. For instance, contrastive analysis hypothesis predicts that a Moroccan student who is going to learn English as a foreign language will have to deal with the interference of two or three languages, including Arabic, French, and Amazigh. Consequently, contrastive analysis hypothesis predicts that Moroccan English language learners will make the following mistakes. They will start sentences with the verbs as in Arabic. They will use feminine E for female referenced words as in French. They will use sentences without the verb to be as in Arabic. They will use water in the plural form as in Amazigh. They will use false friends which they transfer from French into English. Thus, teachers and textbook designers need to be aware of these errors and provide practice activities that will help prevent them before they happen. However, when these errors happen, teachers need to provide immediate feedback and correction followed by repetition of the correct form. However, contrastive analysis hypothesis was criticized for two main reasons. The first reason is that some of the errors that it predicted did not actually happen. Students did not make these mistakes or errors. The second reason is that it did not predict some of the errors which students actually made, because these errors were not related to the difference between the first and second language. They were mainly caused by the overgeneralization of second language rules. This is illustrated in the following examples. Eventually, contrastive analysis hypothesis was replaced by its weak version, which is error analysis. The difference between contrastive analysis and error analysis is that contrastive analysis tried to predict errors and prevent them before they even happen, whereas error analysis tries to deal with errors after they happen, in an attempt to explain their origins and find reasons why students made these errors in order to provide them with the appropriate feedback and remedial work. In the end, the behaviorist theory of second language acquisition received some harsh criticism because of some limitations. First, it was claimed that behaviorism overuses mechanical blind repetitions, which consequently killed the learner's creativity. Behaviorism was also criticized because it focuses too much on accuracy and ignores fluency, and that it does not tolerate errors at all, despite the fact that there are some errors which do not affect the meaning of the message, and these errors should be tolerated. Another criticism that was leveled against the behaviorist approach to second language acquisition is that it does not recognize the role of the internal factors such as feelings, thoughts, and cognitive processes in affecting learning. Finally, behaviorism does not take into consideration individual differences among learners. It treats learners as a herd that learns through repetition and blind mechanical drillings. Despite the harsh criticism which behaviorism has received, no one can deny that it is one of the most influential second language acquisition theories. Behaviorism has provided the theoretical framework for the first ever scientific language teaching method, which is that of audiolingualism, and it is the main theoretical foundation for another method, which is the total physical response. Even today, instances of behaviorism are still identified in practices and techniques used by teachers in modern-day language classrooms. See you in the next video.